Given that Qantas has no peer in Australia, how do you define and establish best practice for the finance division?
I think we look at our finance peers. So there's never a state where you can be satisfied with what the position that you're in and how well your function is operating. So I think you've got to cope with a business that constantly changes. And I think sometimes you have to push the reset button and rethink what you do. And some of the things that have been in place for a long period of time that you've grown comfortable with, sometimes you forget that they get out of date as well. So just ensuring that that you have the right, if you like, rethinking and reevaluating of what you do is important in our industry. And I think it's important for Qantas as well, because it's constantly changing, and making sure that you're providing the right information to the right people in the right time is what it's all about.
How have you gone about planning your career?
I don't think I really had a career plan. I first moved into Qantas out of investment banking for a bit of a lifestyle change, and that was to not be travelling so much and to not work so silly hours. But I soon found that it was in my nature to be a bit of a perfectionist, no matter what position I was in. So I don't believe I really had a career path, but I was identified, at a very early stage of my career by the senior people in finance, so particularly the former CFO Peter Gregg, and he was very good at managing my career. So he put me in, you know, the areas where I needed to be skilled, and that was either in financial reporting or treasury or other areas of the business. So that was quite instrumental to me having the right skills to take on the position.
Do you find that it's lonely at the top? I mean, do you get a sense of isolation being the CFO for such a large organisation? And if so, how do you address that?
It is very lonely, and I think that's where you do need to, you know, I've obviously got the CEO, so I can talk to him, and he's obviously a little lonelier than I am, but I'm very fortunate that he can grasp the financial issues quite quickly, so it's always good to speak to them. And I think CFOs, the chairman of the audit committee is also a very important relationship as well, and I'm quite fortunate to have a very good chairman of the audit committee who I also will discuss some of the key issues with. So there's always relationships around that you can rely on, but that's probably the thing that I found most challenging is the sense of isolation, that because I was a deputy CFO for a long time, so I'd often It's often always good to throw some of the more challenging decisions up the line and get a view. But when the buck stops with you, in most cases, then that luxury isn't there. So it is a little lonely, but there are always relationships that you can go to. And I think that those of the CEO, the chairman of the audit committee, and even some of the directors is always helpful.
What sort of continuing education do you undertake?
I think I've always liked to read, so reading is always helpful. So continuing education, I think, is very important. So if you find a topic that you like, then I find that I immerse myself in it. So I'll read very widely on either accounting or economic theory, or even treasury management. So quite often read either normal texts or periodicals, so that's quite important to do. In terms of formal study, I kind of probably left that, to be honest, about maybe nine or 10 years ago. And I found that I was getting so much on-the-job training that in many cases what I was doing was probably a little ahead of some of the theory. But I do think one thing that is important is that you always go back to the fundamentals, and particularly in what we've been through in the recent economic crisis, is whenever you see the market or businesses or things moving away from what you know is fundamentally correct, I think it's always time to question. So when there's a new theory or there's a quantum shift or a paradigm shift or whatever anyone calls it, then always be a little sceptical and make sure it reconciles back to some of the principles and the fundamentals that you've learnt in your education, because it's always a handy smell test to see whether something's going to work in the long run or not. So there's plenty of times where markets get out of equilibrium, but they ultimately get pulled back, and you've got to be aware of where that happens so that you're not caught in the middle of a crisis or you stray too far from what you should be doing.
What career advice do you have for new finance graduates who are just starting out in their career?
Just take on anything that you are interested in. Always helps if you're passionate about something. So quite often you'll get exposure as a young graduate to all different types of a finance function. So in a finance operation of a large company, it's a very diverse operation. So you can go from into an operational finance role to a head office role. And it gives you an opportunity to test out what you really like. And if you find something that you like and you're passionate about it, then dive in. And sometimes if you think you might like it and you know nothing about it, then also put your hand up, because there's nothing like stretching yourself and getting thrown in the deep end and seeing whether you can absorb it and get on top of things pretty quickly. So I think there's plenty of opportunities where you get thrown into something and then in 6 months you can pick up on things pretty well and move forward in your career. And I think people will look for people that want to take on a challenge and are not just stuck in the role that they're doing and are willing to move forward.
Colin Storrie, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you, Stuart.